Hey, everybody, that's it for the talks for today, but it doesn't mean the convention is over. No, no, no. We have after hours events. That's right. It's 2000. If you're using military time, 8 o'clock, it's convention time. And guess what? Today, that's Sunday, we have an incredible event for you. Escape This Podcast, a live event. So watch the stream, play along. It's coming at you pretty soon or right now. It honestly depends when this message is playing, but it's 8 o'clock convention time. You know what to do.
I think we're live. Hello, everybody. I hope you can see me. Oh, look. Oh, we had two Harrisons for a second.
Yeah.
Double dose.
Welcome, everybody, to this live episode of Escape This Podcast. Technically, it's not a podcast. We probably should have called it Escape This Live Stream, but we're past that issue now. We're Escape This Podcast Live Stream Edition. We have today an audio escape room that Danny has created and will be running. It exists just in her mind and on the tablet in front of her. And we have three fantastic guests who I will let introduce themselves in a second, but only when I say so. That's the control I wield for the next 4 minutes before Danny takes over. Our guests, you've just seen Harrison Greenbaum, who has miraculously changed clothes in an instant. We also have Emily Jillette and Neil Patrick Harris. Welcome, everybody.
Hi, everybody.
Hello.
Hello.
Would each of you like to give a quick introduction as to who you are and what you do in the sort of escape room world? Emily, would you like to start?
Shotgun. Okay. My name is Emily Jillette, and I'm a huge escape room participant. I haven't done that many online until this pandemic, and I did so many with Harrison and Neil. My husband is Penn the Magician, which is kind of like the thread that is how I know Neil and Harrison to begin with. And I'm ecstatic to be here and watch Harrison solve puzzles.
Now you're selling yourself short because I heard on the grapevine that you were the Magic Castle Escape Room champion.
Well, I was on the team, but Neil was on it, and the Pitchfords and Erica Larson, and we killed it. We killed it, but Neil really was a superstar. I remember because he had all the magic knowledge. It was very themed.
I was also the president of the Magic Castle at that time. And so I didn't cheat. I actually love the idea of doing an escape room at the Magic Castle. I feel like that's a fantastic collaboration. I'll go second. I'm Neil. I act sometimes. I was introduced by Harrison earlier today. I am the creator of Box One, a tabletop role-playing game. I'm a huge enthusiast of this kind of stuff. I listen to Escape This Podcast on the regular. I just finished Solve This Murder. Consume This Media is awesome. And I have taken to collecting and doing the tabletop games and trying to solve them and then keeping them in immaculate condition and then not giving them to anyone, just making sure I don't write on anything or damage anything. And then I have no idea what to do with them when it's done. So if anyone has any tips or suggestions for that, I'm just stacking up these weird boxes that I'm never, ever going to use again, but I'm keeping them as if it's some sort of museum. I don't quite understand why or what I'm supposed to do with them.
The appeal of a museum.
And I'm also in Croatia, where it is now 2:06 in the morning, and I just arrived today from New York. So I'm going to be marginal at best, useless likely, and I hope to not curse Lisa. Thank you. I rest my case.
Lovely. And Harrison.
Hey, Croatia is the Las Vegas of Europe. Did you know that? I made that up. It's nice to be here, everybody.
Or Branson.
I just ran over from, I produce an immersive magic show that combines magic and escape rooms called the Society of Conjurers and Magicians, also known as The Scam. That's why I'm dressed like the devil in a community theater production of Damn Yankees. I'm a comedian and a magician and a third thing. And I have been I've been eliminated from all of your favorite reality television competitions. I'm very good at getting to the second round of things.
Were you on AGT?
I was eliminated.
How'd that go?
Last Comic Standing, eliminated. Fool us, they filmed me, didn't even air me. That's just me being more efficient at being eliminated. I'm getting better at it.
Wow, you're so good at losing at these things. It's amazing, it's impressive.
Production, can we get-
You can't get eliminated from this, right? Oh no! There goes my feed.
I think three's, yeah, there we go. now that we've met everybody, the only difference in format that makes this such a special live stream is that on the Discord, everybody who's watching along is chatting along. And I know at least two out of the three of you can see that live, but I'll be monitoring it as well. Anytime you think I'm looking lovingly at Danny, I'm actually looking past her to where I can see the Discord screen. So there are plenty of people in there. Alan Koo is starstruck. And I can just say that to him. Errol is saying, huzzah, look at all that. So we can see that. So as you go, now they're all talking to me. Harrison and Emily can see what you are putting there. So if you think you have an answer to a puzzle and you're like, I've got it, you should do this.
Just brag about it rather than actually saying what the solution is.
Try not to just solve everything in there. If we see Emily go, what I think we should do is I thought of it all by myself. We'll know that. You can also, everybody who's playing along, there will be some visual images that go along with the room. There'll be a map that you can see and little visual puzzles and things written down just to break up the format a little bit. They'll all be posted in the main chat. So not the thread that you're talking in, but the main chat where only I may post. So I'll be putting those there. And so our players can see those, and so can you playing along at home. I think we're all ready to go.
Oh, yeah. I'm good to go.
I'm going to shuffle away.
Everybody seems so nice in the Discord, but I was really looking forward to being heckled for the first time during an escape room.
That's true. I'm glad I can't see the chat. People are just going to be saying, stupid.
All right. Ready to get into this?
I'm ready.
Let's do it.
So again, you are all one person here. You look around the thick trees and you wipe the sweat off your forehead. You think you're going the right way. It's hard to keep track of directions in a jungle. But your footprints have left a very clear path from your starting point. You haven't accidentally circled around on them yet. You are lucky enough to be the new laboratory assistant at the Carolus Institute, the greatest place for zoological research in the country. You had all sorts of dreams about what your first job with the Institute would be. And on the plus side, this job should have you meet one of the great entomologists of your time, Dr. Kim Falkins. On the not so plus side, you aren't sure if you'll be meeting her dead or alive. See, Dr. Falkins has been doing some deep dive research on a few specific species of jungle insects, which involves her camping in the deepest, darkest area for months at a time. Her only connection to the outside world was a walkie-talkie connected to Brian back at the lab. But a few days ago, she ceased all contact and no one knows why. You're the lucky one who's been chosen to find her. Or what's left of her.
After she's an entomologist named Kim Falkins. Her last name is Birds and she studies bugs. That's a tremendous missed opportunity. That's like a dermatologist being named Dr. Tush.
Wow. After hours of trekking, you spot a flash of blue amongst all the browns and greens. A tent! You found her camp. But what's going on with the ground? It's getting softer and not in a nice way. The closer you get to your goal, the more your shoes are sticking. And you realize Dr. Falkins has set up her camp in the middle of a ring of quicksand. You didn't even know this stuff was a real thing that you'd ever have to be worried about in real life. But it's okay. Now that you're looking around, you see that Dr. Falkins has set up a wooden plank across the shortest quicksand gap between her island and the shore. You head for it and walk carefully, fascinated by how well it stays floating on the surface, even under your full weight. Then, just as you're about to step onto the island, The whole thing snaps. Most of the plank bridge topples sideways and immediately sinks down, and you're left on the tiniest shard. You leap for the island. You make it. And as soon as your foot hits land, a rope trap springs up from under you, hugs all around your body tight, and zooms you up into the air attached to a tree branch. You gasp in pain. The trap digs into your skin. And not only that, you manage to sweep up the shard of wooden plank with you. And it's really pointy. And worst of all, even though you're making an incredible amount of noise, you don't see any sign of Dr. Falcons. You are going to have to look around and get yourself out of here. And
I'll tell you this, it's the last time I go basic economy on JetBlue.
All right, we're posting the map into the chat. And I believe we were offered the services of an actual illustrator, but I said, no, I've got this.
Nay.
So you can take a look at all of the little things that you've got on there. Oh. You can ask about anything that you see, and you see the big tree with the ropey-looking trap. That is where you currently are.
Okay.
Can I ask a question? What is? Let's look at what's closest to us first, right? So what are the black little things at the bottom of the tree and the rungs and the little black piece that was near it?
There is an awful lot of stuff going on at that tree. You're right. So you look out of the trap at the tree. The only true branch is the one that you're hanging from. It's higher than you'd want. So above you, just a thick cluster of leaves. And below you, the entire base of the tree is crawling with bugs. This tree must be a major food source for them. You hope you're not going to be the major food source for them. And there is also something else down there, as you can see. It's more within reaching distance if you were on the ground, but it's still quite visible from your position. Nailed to the trunk of the tree is a clipboard.
And can we kind of swing ourselves and use the sharp pointy stick to grab that clipboard? Is that within our ability?
You stick your arm out of the trap, and even with a bit of swinging, it's not quite within your grasp. You can actually get a decent look at it. It looks like Dr. Falcons has surprisingly large handwriting. So you can get a bit of a look at what's on there. It's a bit eaten around the edges, but that's another image that's going on there. That should be called tree clipboard.
Tree clipboard. Okay.
I curse out the tree and threaten to turn it into books.
Catch and release program. Have patched up the hole again. Animal subjects continue to gnaw open at structurally weak points that unravel whole trap, causing severe injury. They seem unable to pinpoint designated safe escape breaking spot. Perhaps the thorns leading them to it are too large. We'll need to reevaluate. Team?
That was not your fault, by the way. It would have been easier for him to read in Croatian.
Easier with my glasses on. Okay.
You take a look at that, and then you take a look at the trap that's actually holding you, and you thought it was made of rope, but now that you've read that, it makes it a little bit clearer. This is actually a very flexible, sinewy wood. It stretches wide enough to hold you, but tight enough that it hurts, and there are a few thorns all over the place on it. And
can we see this other tree? Is that, like, near us? There's like a dead tree in front of us?
A stump?
Yes, there is a bit of a stump. You can't get too much detail of it from up here, but it does look like it was cut at some point, and you suspect maybe from the type of wood that it is that Dr. Falcons cut it to make that wooden bridge that no longer exists.
So we need to find the weak points that will let us out without, like, dropping us on our head.
Pretty much.
Yeah, so I would think that they would be under us rather than over us, right? I've never been in one of these contraptions, but I would want my feet to...
Oh, I know some bars in New York that we can go to.
No, like if you undid it from above...
That's right.
You have a neon rooster on the front.
Yeah, so you poke around and you look for where seems to be a structurally weak point, like at the seams of this net.
Yeah.
The wood is tough enough that it doesn't seem like something you can just rip with your hands easily, even at the weak points. But right. You do find a spot where something has clearly gotten through it before, because there is one patch that looks like it has been patched up in a very different way that does not match the normal crisscrossy pattern of the rest. This was made in a very particular way. And this image where you can see which is on the lower side towards the tree trunk.
Oh,
my.
I see. It's wild.
Okay.
Oh, that's so thorny.
So thorny. Okay, so it's somewhat of a...
I love it. It's sort of labyrinthine. So we have to figure out, I see, oh, this is so crazy. So we're going to have to cut portions of this, I'm guessing, with the shard of wood that we have, right? And we have to probably cut the right shards in order to not fall and break a collarbone and just fall gently down. Thoughts, Harrison?
Yeah, and some of the thorns seem to be not labeled, but some of them have three on top, one on the bottom.
Yeah.
Some have two on top, two on the bottom. So there seems to be some interest with the where the thorns are placed and how many, and particularly where.
Right.
And if you're looking for any help in the Discord chat, they're mostly just posting GIFs of people falling over and cats getting caught in cages.
I'm gonna look, guys. All right.
So what could that mean? Let's talk it out so we're not just staring at this thing.
Yeah.
There's things that sort of match each other. There are some that both have two thorns. There's some that have four, two up, two down. There's four. There's there's two triple thorns.
Right. So
is there anything?
Somebody seems wisely suggesting to follow by quantity. So maybe we go from like the one, the lower right hand one. But even I don't know what I mean by going. Am I cutting it or
What are we trying to preserve? I just want to make sure I'm clear with the goal. So we want everything to stay attached to the four corners and eliminate everything else.
How it is with rope traps, it can just be that even one cut in exactly the right place can unravel a whole thing.
And our leg is like tied inside. We're inside it this way, or our leg is inside it.
No, you are fully enclosed inside it like a cartoon.
Got it. So we just want to open it up so we can get out.
Yeah, but you don't want, like, if you unravel it in the wrong place, who knows, the entire thing could unravel and just straight up drop you. But apparently there is a designated safe release somewhere in here.
Okay.
And Dr. Falcon said in her note, perhaps the thorns leading them to it are too large. We'll need to reevaluate in her thing. That could be a clue of some sort.
So the two in the upper left are clearly much larger. And then actually there's three that are pretty big over on the right.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a big one that's one?
Two.
Nah, I think it's just those are the only large ones.
Okay.
My gosh, what am I missing? I'm just not even sure what I'm supposed to be doing.
No.
Like if you hypothetically cut one thing, does then some of it drop away? Is that what we're trying to imagine? And how can we drop away the slightest amount?
Hold on.
Is there anything else on the map that we can see that would give us a hint?
Yeah, there's also that like shish kebab in the fire. Is that something that we can see that might be of interest?
Most of the other stuff as you get further away from the tree would be, you'd be better off taking a look at it once you're free.
You can do
this in a self-contained way now.
So the two and the three do connect.
Are we able to solve this now just using this?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And when you solve it, you'll be pretty, you won't be confused.
You will know that you've got it. It's
all right. Okay. I'm going to go back and read that letter again. Hold on.
So you follow the one from the top left corner and you imagine that that's like a tunnel and you follow it all the way around. It links you to a split that goes to the bottom corner and then it comes back up and around and then dead ends. And then the other one goes to sort of top middle. So that one seems to be attached to a lot of things. I'm just trying to trace different paths from certain dead ends and certain corners to see where they lead.
Going around the clock that way, the one that's at 12 o'clock, if you cut that, that's pretty, that's sort of self-contained. It starts with that the four thorns and goes just around and up to the corner. So you could theoretically cut that, like the 12 o'clock, the 1 o'clock, and the 3 o'clock, and just have that little quadrant go away.
Tracing is definitely a good word to use for this one.
Oh, wait, are they spelling letters? Am I being... I'm seeing a letter Y. I'm actually seeing a letter H in the top left corner. I'm seeing an H. And then it says here, actually, I think it says H-E-R-E, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh, yes, you're right. You're right.
Oh, Harrison, you're so good.
Originally, I thought it said whore without a W, H-O-R-E, and I was very confused about this puzzle. But now that it looks like it says here, I am feeling better about it.
Yeah, why don't we cut away at the thing that says here? That kind of makes sense as puzzle one.
Kind of.
So,
does the crowd agree with this?
You're getting there. The problem is the one that says here, as you said, that's connected to almost all of them in a certain way. So I think there's something very specific about this. And again, tracing could help out here.
All right, I'm going to draw.
You are so close.
Here, and then...
Oh, and then it's an arrow.
Yeah, there's an arrow pointing at the two thorny thing. So it's literally saying here with an arrow going this way, which to those who are only listening means to the left. Can we cut the two thorny point?
Do you see that, Emily?
Arrow is pointing to?
I see the here. I don't see the arrow.
So keep following the E from the here, and it wraps around and makes like the outline of an arrow, like a neon arrow.
Cool. Yeah.
If you go from big thorn to big thorn, you will get here and that arrow pointing you towards a little two thorny spot. So you take your stick shard and you stab at it or slice at it, whatever seems to be working, but you make headway and soon that bit of branch snaps open. And then so does the one next to it and the one next to it. And then that's it. You've got a modest hole, one that you can now squeeze through without the entire thing collapsing. Oh, just the right angle. You reach out, you grab the junction of tree trunk and branch that's holding you. You wriggle free, you clamber, and then you make it most of the way down. And then you jump off so that you avoid the bugs at the base that are getting too close for comfort. Yeah. Ow, that landing hurt, but it could have been a lot worse. So now you are free to explore the camp to find what you can of Dr. Falcons.
Well done, Katniss. All right. Why don't we look at the fire thing that you were looking at before?
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. So,
by the way, Danny, that was great.
that was fun. Sitting beside the fire pit, there's this trestle of clothes. I assume that's what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, you examine these. They've been poorly layered, so everything is covered up with everything else. There's a lot of them, but they are bone dry, which leaves you assuming they must have been here for a while. There's a little bit of everything, thick trousers, shorts, jackets, even a pair of glasses hanging out of one of the pockets. And you have no reason to believe that these are anything but Dr. Falcons' clothes.
We grab the glasses just in case we need like magnification or to start a fire of any kind. Can we do that?
For sure.
Is the color order have any significance?
No.
And what are the flags? What are these
anything
flags?
Else? Anything else before we split there in the pockets or anything else if we look through them?
No extra searching.
Glasses. Love it.
Does she have any proof of vaccination?
In the jungle, I should hope she's got more than you.
Okay, fair enough. I see a little walkie-talkie right before the flags. Do we want to go over to that?
Yeah, that seems like a great way to get back in contact with the lab. You switch it on. And your heart sinks. Its frequency is set to 000.000. You have no idea what the lab's frequency settings are. There are so many possibilities. But okay, if Dr. Falcons was in the habit of resetting her walkie-talkie after every use, she must have had something written down somewhere to help her remember, right?
Yeah.
Just to be thorough, you flip over the walkie-talkie to check the back, and to your surprise, there's something that has been marked on there in what I would call a texter. I guess what you would call just a marker. And that will be coming.
See it.
I like that everybody in the play along thread is just posting GIFs of whatever keyword you say.
Yeah, I saw that.
I hoped people would do that with emojis when they had something that they want to say, check out that, check out the glasses, 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 glasses.
Yeah, there you go. What's the frequency, Kenneth?
Oh,
all right. Can we try the frequency 69.69 and just say anybody up? just to check. We don't know.
Emily's laugh right there. That is what you hear coming out of the other end, but nothing.
Oh, that means there's a person who can hear us. Help us.
Okay, but what does this mean, this thing that we have, though? To the left in is like a dark arrow, and then it says sixth, then two, to the left, again, and then first.
Yeah, right. It just looks like Dr. Falcons at some point grabbed a marker and wrote that on the back.
I think it's a puzzle.
Yeah, I think we need more information, though.
That makes so much more sense now.
That's how they get you. They keep putting puzzles in.
Yeah, she has that weird thing where she could just keep things to herself, but instead she does very subtle clues. Every time they're like, oh, we stored the antidote, but if you can figure out the code in the periodic table that's right next to the safe, the antidote is all yours.
Not set up like this?
What? Before we get to the flags, let's look at the fire pit.
Yes.
And no worries. You can tell very easily there has not been a fire in here for several days. There's not even any wood left in it or beside it to be a future supply. It is abandoned. The only thing remaining is a pile of soot and ash accumulated from however long it's been since she last cleaned the thing out. And apparently that was some time ago.
And if we take the soot and rub it on the back of the walkie-talkie, does that reveal any messages, just in case?
It doesn't. However, as you go through and you lift up a handful of soot, your hand actually touches something in the pit. Something hard is in there. And in fact, what you uncover is a clipboard, much like the one stuck to the tree. Paper notes on a metal backboard. The first page, totally illegible. It's been buried. But you flip that over and the second page is relatively intact.
Ooh.
Nicely done, Harrison.
Just call me the soot man. I hope that one doesn't stick.
Cricket's observational data, numerical.
Okay, Cricket's observational data, numerical, evening Thursday. I think it's Thursday today. And let me zoom in. There's the names of different species, their arrival time, when the first sound happened, the frequency, and the leaving time. Used smoke to attract for first sighting. So cool. So we might want to ignite a fire at some point. Also, the names seem to be Latin.
They are real cricket names.
OPP.
So wait.
No one said it? Interesting.
We should get the
Bill is now posting an updated walkie-talkie based on your actions.
It's so nothing.
Nothing has happened. He's just having
I'm just
fun.
Trying
Ignore
to,
him.
I'm just trying to maintain a sense of.
That does look sooty.
Did you say that this page looks like a page that's over on the tree on the clipboard? We didn't grab that, did we?
It does look like the same style of clipboard. The paper itself, obviously, different because you read what was on that other one. You take a look back at the clipboard that was on the tree, and yikes! Remember those bugs that were crawling around the base? They have now. Swarmed the entire trunk, and you can tell they are some nasty-looking fire ants. The clipboard is barely visible now. So you back away. You've heard that those things can be extremely painful.
Gotcha. The only thing I'm noticing is that there are six species, and our little circle said sixth on it. I do not know if there's a connection, but just to put that out there. And before
and we need six numbers of frequency is 000.000.
Right.
And is there anything in the tent? Just to make sure we're not like overlooking the scavenging. Is there just anything in the tent that we can find?
Oh, makes sense. Who knows? Dr. Falcons might be in there. No time to worry about invading privacy. You lift up the tent flap and no, she's not there. Is she? The contents of the tent are quite sparse. There's not even a sleeping bag, just some basic hygiene products, brush, toothbrush, a lot of deodorant cans, and then wedged up against the side. So it almost looks like part of the tent itself is one thing that stands out. There's a strange metal rod.
Can we look at it closer and see what this rod is?
Yeah, you aren't totally sure how to describe it. It's like, it's as long as maybe a cane. It's a dull silver, and it's got a thin cable wrapped around it leading to what looks like a battery pack near the top. So it's electronic somehow. You follow the cable to see where the bottom end leads, but it comes to an abrupt end with tiny prongs. So it's meant to connect to something, but you can't really imagine what. It doesn't look like it does anything on its own.
So it's long metal rod with a little tying on the end, and then it's wire on the other side?
It's got wires sort of surrounding, starting from the top and coiling around the metal rod, and then that's what comes to prongs at the other end.
I feel like it could be used to electrocute or be some kind of electromagnet. We're going to need some kind of battery or something maybe to power it. And I guess the only thing we haven't inspected is are these flags that are out there. There's lots of colored flags.
There are still a couple of other things potentially to look at least one other thing. Don't forget, you can look at everything that's on there. But yeah, these brightly colored flags, they're dotted all over this part of the island, all different colors. None of them seem to be pointing anywhere of interest. They lift up easily enough, but since you don't know exactly what they're indicating, you try to keep everything as is for now.
Okay. You guys, team, do you think that maybe the frequency is set based on those single-digit numbers? I just put them in first sound order. I mean, do you want to give that a try? Like, do you understand what I'm saying? So 725.433?
Is that a frequency?
You
can try it.
Yeah.
Sure.
You give that a go, and all you get is static, unfortunately. There's okay. Something else to it.
Yeah. All right.
I'm looking at the numbers that are on here, right? They arrive. So the first species arrived at 20 o'clock and then it left at 2010. So there's a 10 minute discrepancy. I'm ignoring the first sound for right now. Then the second one arrived at 1930 and left at 20. So that's a difference of 30 minutes. The third one's 1945 to 1950 is only 5 minutes. Then it goes to 35 minutes, 45 minutes, and 25 minutes. So they're all different. There's a sequence of the duration of those, but I don't know how the first sound would play into that. Because the first one arrived, and then the first sound was 5 minutes earlier, and then it left later. But it seems that the second one arrived, and the first sound was 10 seconds later. So I'm not quite sure how. I feel like there's a connection there between, like, that is going to get us our sequence.
How might the walkie-talkie message code thing have fit into that as well?
Yeah, it is weird that the first sound sometimes comes before the arrival, and sometimes it comes after the arrival.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sometimes the bugs are just like, I'm coming! And then they turn up afterwards. It takes them a while.
Charles Nelson Reilly is one of the bugs.
I'm a mentologist.
This is like a very quality cast. I like that. Everybody who's over 30, 40 laughed, and everybody else is furiously Googling old Match Game episodes.
Yes, we're reading the chat. They're asking, oh, look, they put him up right away. I don't mind spoilers. Oh, look, Tammy's here to help. Remember Tammy? Remember Tammy, Neil?
Oh, Tammy.
Yeah.
I just want to make sure we were playing with all the information. It's possible that we can solve this puzzle just with this and the circle, but just to make sure we're not missing anything that's just on the island, like in front of us, which is how I get stuck in every escape room, is that we just didn't turn the rug over. Is there anything else of interest, like in the stump, now that we can get close to it, or anything sticking out of the sand?
Not so much. The only other thing that you haven't particularly looked at, sorry, you're saying hold on.
Oh, Emily looks like she's made a break.
Well, no, I just love Tammy's hint because Tammy's the best in the world, right? Can we use Tammy's hint?
What is her hint?
Tammy has a hint. She says, I think the left arrow means order by the time the cricket left. Get it? Left? So that would be like, we can do this. That would be 7524333. Is that right? Did I get that right?
That is the order that they left. Can you read what's on that walkie-talkie code out loud? Can someone read what's in the circle out loud?
Left 6-2 left first.
Hold on. Cool. It's very
exceedingly close.
Left 6-2 left first.
Left 6-2.
Oh, leave last who left first. So,
yes, you want who left sixth all the way up to who left first.
So it's 3-4-5-2-7.
2-5. Is it 2-5-7 or
3? Oh, I don't know. 3-3.
You got the puzzle. It's fine.
3-3. You do it. 4-5-2-7.
All right. Left six to left first.
That's a good clue. Who knows? You fiddle with the walkie-talkie until the frequency reaches what you're after. Then you press the big button to talk. Hello?
Brian.
Brian. There's a wait, and then you hear, this is Brian. Have you found Falcons? You explain everything that you have seen so far, and Brian sounds disheartened, but not all that surprised. In fact, he goes on to tell you, oh, yeah, you know, before the communications vanished, Dr. Falcons would check in every day, and they got weirder and weirder. The solitude, it was getting to her for sure. In fact, her last one, oh, she sent it several days ago. I recorded it. It was that bizarre. You want to hear it?
Yeah. Totally.
Maybe it'll help you find her. All right, you hear, there's a pause while Brian gets things set up. And then the next sound that comes through is a fuzzy version of Dr. Falcons' voice, speaking curt sentences with long gaps between them. Listen to these instructions to the letter, Brian. Be diligent. Elementary advice. Useful to remember. Even out here in the jungle. Especially out here in the jungle. Got that? Now, remember, between, and then it cuts off. That's it. You can't.
I've solved that.
Yes.
Do it. Can I be proud of myself because I was so terrible at that last frequency one?
Do it.
So to the letter, I was listening for letter sounds, and she said B, and then L. And then useful and even and especially. And if you put those letters together, it spells blues. That's all I got. I don't know what to do with it, but that's what I have.
That's very good. And it
spelled a word.
Yeah. And I'm not saying it's an easy puzzle, but it's literally blues clues.
I'm and so proud of myself for saying this.
I'm proud of you too. The chat, by the way, it's good that you can't read it, Neil, because some very kind person named Jessica said, oh my God, it's like playing with my parents.
I get it. I'm putting on my readers in order to solve the puzzles.
But we got a lot of bravos on that. So we're back in the game.
And now, thanks. What to do with it?
Blue. Yeah.
Oh.
Are there some flags that are blue? Is it worth inspecting the flags that are particularly blue? I see a couple towards the bottom left, like a sky blue and a dark blue.
Yeah, there are a couple of blue flags. You take a look at them. They don't seem any different from the other flags, annoyingly.
But can we, like, dig in between them?
Yeah, you can dig in between them. In fact, if you recall, what was the end of that message that got cut off?
Between.
Mm. So you pace out halfway between those two blue flags and you start to dig in the dirt with your hands. It's looser than you would expect, even as you get deeper down. That's got to be a good sign.
It's going to be a dead body. It's Dr. Kim Falcons. I know it.
Oh, no.
Also, looser than expected was my Tinder profile.
Nice.
After a few minutes, I don't want to read this next sentence anymore. After a few minutes, your fingers scrape against something very solid and you uncover it and pull it up. And it's a metal disc. It's about the size of a dinner plate. Thickness.
Disc? You said disc?
Disc.
Okay.
What does it sound like? It's about the thickness of a textbook and it's got funny grooves all over the top and bottom. It's very heavy. And right in the top center, there's a set of holes that look like maybe something could plug into that.
Oh, we have a rod.
On a totally different note, looking back in the hole that you've made, there is something else down there. You see a glimmer of silver and you reach down and there is a third clipboard.
Ooh.
Let's take a look at that third clipboard.
All right, the third clipboard is coming up and you got this metal thing. You can look at them in whatever order you please.
Quicksand, the dangers of quicksand are greatly exaggerated by media. Simple physics and physiology mean a human body cannot sink fully below the surface and suffocate. However, even when buried only up to the legs or chest, freeing oneself is no simple task. Always have either supervision or a good tether. As for getting past quicksand, a bridge of natural wood does quite well, though squares of light metal, such as aluminum, can be even more effective footholds if placed correctly. I'll just fly across, it says in the corner.
And I think you'll find you may have slightly misread that. It doesn't say aluminum. It says the correct...
Aluminium.
Thank you.
Aluminium. Apologies. It's funny that I said aluminum because I rail about that to my kids all the time. I have no idea why Americans call it aluminum. It makes no sense at all. Like, it literally has an eye in the middle of it.
Because hey everybody, welcome to Aluminium.
Please
facts.
Keep solving puzzles. We don't have time for sidetracks.
So the person who first identified aluminium as an element called it aluminum. He said, "This is called aluminum. That's its name." And then the British Board of Sciences said, What are you doing? Everything else ends with IUM, you idiot. Change it. Really? He went, "Oh, I'll change it." But Americans went, "No, we prefer the original way. We're gonna stay true to the creator's vision." And that's how it happened.
Interesting. Thanks for the fun fact, Bill.
Relevant.
I'm just giving him time to solve the puzzle.
But do we want to plug? My only nervousness about plugging that metal rod directly with the two prongs into the two thing is that if it is electric and we're holding it, we might electrocute ourselves. So can we use the clipboard like gloves, like holding the clipboard on either side, so that we have a sort of buffer?
Well, the clipboards are light metal themselves, so who knows
that's
how this
works. That's what I was going to say. The clipboards might be the squares of light metal, right?
Can't we step across using the clipboards?
Yeah.
All right, so that's an interesting thought. So as you get ready to use them as gloves, but as you do, you see them and you go... then you look over at the quicksand itself, and so it's perfectly innocent, perfectly still, but so, so dangerous. Now, the thing is, even at the most narrow point, if you just like made a little bridge out of these two clipboards that you have in your hands, there's no way you could get across that way. It looks like it would take maybe 5 jumps to get across. So 4 metal squares might get you there at the best.
And so we need to get that clipboard off of the tree. So could we zap the ants or the bugs or whatever?
Well, I suppose we'll need to figure out exactly how electric this thing is.
What happens when we plug that thing in? Are the prongs matching to the pluggy thing?
Oh, yeah. It looks like it fits in perfectly. You gonna do it? You gonna do it?
Let's do it.
Can we wrap flags around our hands before we plug
sure.
it in?
Why not? Or clothes. There's plenty of clothes there as well. Something's got to be an insulator. You do that. They go together with a satisfying click, and no electricity shoots through anything whatsoever. And now that you have it, so you've got this long stick going to a big round circle. This is not a good hand image for this. But once they're together, suddenly you go, "Oh my God, I know exactly what this is. I have seen this in TV shows all the time. It's a metal detector."
Yeah.
Nice.
Maybe we have to start a fire to attract them, because she told us on her observational data that the smoke would attract them. Maybe that'd get them away from the clipboard.
Perfect. Perfect. So can we use the glasses to on some clothes that to start a fire and like get it sparking? What would it be?
The clothes won't be the best of fire, and that may release some toxic fumes that you don't want, depending on what they're made of. Do you have anything that's a bit more normal kindling?
We have all the paper on the clipboards.
Yeah, you've memorized that. you grab off all of that paper, you scrunch it up, you chuck it into the fire, and then you find the best ray of sunlight that you can through the trees and use those glasses, get the right angle. It takes a while, but eventually, oh my gosh. Oh,
please never do this. Oh no.
You see a little line of smoke and then a little burst of flame. And after a while, there's a nice little blaze going.
Nice.
Can we also use the metal detector and just kind of see if maybe there's a clipboard that we can metal detect?
Yeah, absolutely. Yep. You sweep it around the place. You ignore the metal stuff that you've already collected, the clipboards that you've already got. And then as you walk around, what's this? It's picking up something sort of near the tree stump. Hold on. Wait. Beep. That's past the tree stump, close to the edge of the quicksand. Beep. Wait. Make that in the quicksand. Okay. There's something metal in the quicksand. It doesn't seem to be very far out, but you don't know how quickly this quicksand gets crazy deep.
Yeah.
So we can't reach. We can't like kind of lay over the edge and try to reach down.
Doesn't seem to be. You're afraid that your head will go in if you do that.
A bridge of natural wood.
One option would be to, if we're just trying to grab this clipboard, what are the flags made of? Like they're on little sticks, or what is the material they're made out of?
Teeny tiny ones with a little bit of miscellaneous wavy plastic.
Not the size of the flag. It's the how much they weigh.
What about the thing all the clothes is on?
Oh, yeah.
So the big problem is that most of the stuff that you stick into quicksand is going to be awfully hard to get back out again. Especially the larger it gets.
Now, I've done this in the playtest, and I can't remember, and I'm stumped. I've got completely no idea how to do it.
I feel like you just said the word stumped.
I don't know if that was a clue. I hope so.
We have to cut down the tree, maybe. The bigger tree.
But wait, can we use the rope that we had cut, that we got out of, that rope?
It's mostly still attached to the tree, and that's covered in fire ants. Ugh.
And what do we see on this stump when we look at it closely? It's just a stump in the ground. Like, can we pull it up, or is there anything about it?
No, it's very thick. You can't see anything on it.
I think we're going to need to,
Is the smoke making fire? I mean, is the fire making smoke?
A little bit, yes, but it's too far. It doesn't seem to be drifting towards the ants. It doesn't seem to be having any effect.
Put it out then so it smokes?
Yeah, it's smoking enough. Let's just say it is fine for the moment.
All right.
Couldn't we use the shard that we had from before and take out like an ember and bring it over to the tree and disrupt the fire ants that way?
Yeah, you can absolutely try to do that. And as the fire nears the ants, they start to scurry around a bit far. They seem angry, but they don't seem to be leaving. So they're definitely having a reaction, but something isn't quite right about that. And I think that you should focus on this quicksand thing first.
Yeah. Can we use the materials that the tent are made out of? We need some kind of like pole or extension because we can't just put our hand in there.
Maybe.
So can we take the rods out of the tent and fashion some kind of picking up device?
Maybe.
I was wondering if the note that where it says I'll just fly across is like maybe supposed to say across. Is that like a hint of, I don't know. I feel like there's something in there. It looks added later.
It does.
What else?
The note, this clipboard is definitely what you want to be thinking about for this.
Yeah. I'll just fly across.
I mean, like fly fishing? I would like to take, can we take the poles out of the tent?
it's a bit too built up. Let's say no. I have the power here. Let's say no. You won't need to do that. So no, you can't. You don't know what you're doing.
Is anybody else just like unnerved by that plane gift that just got put in the...
Yeah.
That's making me uncomfortable. Please delete this.
So somebody in the chat suggested to make a rope out of the clothes.
She did suggest making a good tether or being supervised when you do this.
Who said that?
Tether. It is in the thing. Okay, so you could tie the clothes to each other and then wrap one end... Tie it to the stump.
Because the stump is in there real good.
You did give an inadvertent hint.
I gave an inadvertent hint.
Dr. Falcons has some pretty sturdy clothes, so you tie them together at the sleeves or the legs, and they hold. It's not a particularly long rope, but it does feel sturdy and reliable, and so you can tie one end to the stump and one end around yourself.
Nice. Let's slowly get messy.
All right, you take your metal detector in, you're firmly secured, you make your way out into the quicksand, you follow its beeping, and you get about hips deep when it hits its maximum beepage. So that's when you stop and you like, use your feet to feel around. It's very difficult, but your toes touch something. You dig your other foot underneath, you bring them a little closer, and then you pull the other foot on top, you get a grip on it, and then you use every ounce of your arm strength to drag yourself back onto the shore. I'm reading my notes. I don't know why Billy's laughing.
It's just a long description for grabbing something.
Here, look at what you've pulled up, and thank God it's another clipboard. Surely this is the last one. It is filthy. Only the final page has anything remotely legible on it. Last one. Oh, last image.
Oh, my bad.
Yay. So close.
Ooh. Barbaric. Smells, attracts, and repels. The smells seem to be different colors.
Oh, they are not different colors.
Well, I mean, vanilla seems white to roses red to lemons yellow. The coffee's brown.
What about pineapple?
Yeah.
Pineapple's orange. Well, we can see
that lavender repels fire ants. So that's a good thing.
Yes.
Those are at the base of the tree. We have another weird thing in the corner. So we have flies across and barbaric. I don't know if we missed on the other ones.
Nah, they were clean.
Okay, flies across and barbaric. And we're looking for lavender, which is a plant.
It's, do we have a lavender flag?
No, it doesn't seem to be.
So helpful.
it was a good suggestion.
You're not thinking in the wrong way.
And is there lavender on the, we're on that little island and then we were trying to get across the way. If we go across, if we run across, not saying we're doing it yet, but we can see across. Do we see any lavender plants on the other side?
Not that you can recognize. And it's probably not just, you know, the plant itself that necessarily repels it. I'm sure that would do the job.
It's the
but...
scent of lavender.
I was trying to solve something when you went through the tent. What was in the tent besides the pole?
Yeah, the weird pole and a lot of various toiletries.
Oh, her deodorant. Does she have lavender deodorant?
Yeah, you can find pretty much any flowery, fruity scent of deodorant in here. It's the jungle. She needed a lot. And you do indeed find a lavender one.
I think we can probably use that deodorant. Should we lather ourselves up just for safety? We cover ourselves in lavender deodorant just to make sure.
We smell great.
We smell amazing.
Oh, man. I hope you don't regret this. All right. So what you're going to do for this, you were totally right with the smoke thing before, but apparently you need to infuse that smoke a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
So you take your stick with a little bit of burning ember at the end of it, and you get the lavender spray deodorant ready. You go over to the tree. And you just
torch them.
You send the wonderfully scented smoke towards the tree.
Oh, yeah, that.
They go berserk. They scurry all over the place. They are desperate to get away. And for a moment, you think you've done it. And then you hear something from higher up in the tree, an ominous buzzing. And you see that something is descending upon you.
The wasps.
They love lavender.
They love lavender.
You try to waft the lavender that you sprayed on yourself off as much as possible. You run to the other side of the island and you go, okay, what do I do now?
Do we have lemons of any kind? Is there a lemon scented deodorant inside the tent?
Totally a lemon scented deodorant.
We rub that all over. We're naked now and we're just lathering ourselves up. And I want you to imagine our three heads on one body lathering.
We're going to wind up at sea lice is going to be a problem.
Do we have any coffee?
There is no coffee scented deodorant or coffee itself.
Coffee.
Sadly. We
can do that with the wasps, and that'll bring the Asian, the assassin beetles.
Hmm.
And then we could probably find something that's cranberry scented, I'm guessing, right?
Yeah, there's cranberry deodorant in there as well.
So cranberry, that's going to attract the sea lice.
Well.
But there's no sea because we're surrounded by quicksand.
There we go.
So we stop there.
You get up the lavender, the lemon, and the cranberry, and you make a super scent out of it. this has got to do the trick. So you go back over to the tree already, spraying with all three of your limbs at once. And the ants scatter. The wasps, they poke their conniving little heads around, but they quickly flee as well. And then from over at the tree stump, you see a warning glimpse of red and black as beetles start coming up. But then as soon as they get close to you, they shudder and they scurry back inside. And after a couple of minutes, once the smoke is all cleared, the tree itself is also clear of insects.
Well done. Well done.
Good work remembering that stuff in the tent, Emily.
Yeah, well done, Emily. So let's grab that fourth clipboard.
Yeah, it is nailed very loosely to the tree. You can grab that easily.
So nailed loosely was my other description.
I thought you were going to do a dung beetle joke instead, but you went to nails loosely. Nice.
What are the odds the assassin beetles are dangerous? Are they is that a real thing?
Assassin beetles are totally real, and some of them are really annoying. Like, they deliberately kill honeybees. Rude.
Very rude.
Neil, weren't you in Sondheim's version of assassin beetles?
Assassin beetles. It's Studio 54. Yeah, it's weird. So if we lay the four clipboards down, we can get across this quicksand.
It's not so much lying them down as, like, gently tossing them and hoping they land flat, but you stand right by the edge of the quicksand. You look back out towards the proper forest floor on the other side. You pick the point where the distance is shortest. And now that you have to trust that Dr. Falcon's observations about the metal were correct. So you frisbee that first clipboard. You cast it out as far as you think you can reasonably step. And it lands on the surface and sits there perfectly flat and calm. It does look like it would get you the right fraction of the way across. So you step out onto it, you clench every muscle really hard so you don't wobble, and then you breathe a sigh of relief. You are standing on quicksand. So you toss another clipboard, another step, another mini heart attack, and then again and again. And then at last you leap off the final one onto sludgy but solid ground. Thanks, Dr. Falcons, you mutter. And to your absolute shock, you hear from off to your left. Do you like to hear me?
Oh.
You're welcome, young grasshopper.
That's a good voice.
There, crouched in a bush, wild hair and even wilder eyes and clothes that look like they were fashioned from the grass and leaves themselves. You recognize this person from her professional headshots, but only barely. Dr. Falcons, I've been... Your camp... What happened to you? I was sent to find you.
They should have known better.
She stands up and walks towards you, but with hunched shoulders and splayed fingers like she'd rather be crawling.
You'd think I'd made it clear, shutting off the walkie-talkie and throwing away all my so-called research. I'm done. I'm never going back. I found a new project now with new employers.
You're aghast. Dr. Falcons has worked in your research center for years. She won all her awards in your labs. She did all the work with your equipment, your assistants. She's practically lived there and had all the other biologists for family. She's found new employers? Who, you ask indignantly?
The insects! Through my research, I have discovered their secrets in ways nobody else has. I've seen how they work, their scurrying little critterful brains, and they are miraculous. The intelligence, the social skills, the great building of society without any of the burdens of human nonsense. It's only a matter of time before they outrank you all, and I'm going to join them for that glorious day.
Okay. 18 months of isolation has done something to her. She comes even closer and you fight the urge to back away and you realize why her eyes look so strange. She's having to squint in that unique way that a person does when they're in denial about needing glasses. She had glasses and real clothes and a job, but she's playing thug.
You, young grasshopper.
She raises a finger to point and she actually pokes you in the nose and it does not smell good.
You have proven yourself. You would make a worthy addition to the hive. Come, I'll bet you've heard the name Kim Falcons. You must know the great work I've done. I'll bet my antennae you've always wanted to work alongside me, and I'm willing to offer you the chance. All you have to do is shed your Homo sapiens skin and use your skills to serve a new queen society.
This is not the decision you thought you'd be facing when you got up for work this morning. Guess you'd better answer her. And you'd better make it a good answer, because there is every chance she might bite. And that is the end of your escape room.
Thank God. I thought we were missing a meta puzzle where we were going to have to actually answer and do something.
Oh my God. I was like, I wish we bought the pointy stick. I wasn't going to murder her, but I wasn't not going to murder her. I was going to introduce her as Paul Fire Ants, an eminent Falcon studier.
Oh, well done to all of you. Same.
Yes, congratulations.
Was very intimidating. I will say, having done an Escape This podcast a couple of times, you know, Bill gets to edit out the awkward 3.5 minutes of staring at nothing, trying to figure out a solution, and instead realizing that there's a chat group of people who are designing these things and who know how all of this stuff works was made me feel like more of an aged dunce than I have already felt in my life.
Wasn't it? Yeah, doing it with a chat, it's terrifying.
We have occasionally streamed cryptic crosswords on Twitch before, and it's so depressing because everyone in the chat is like, got it, done, solved them all. What are you talking about? You fools? You fools?
Oh, that was so fun.
That was so fun. I just put the link of the gift they put in the chat, if you like it.
Nice.
It's not from me, it's from them, but.
Amazing.
Wow, that is a lot of pressure though, with everybody there knowing the answers already.
It's tough. But you all did very well. Like you were quick. You got plenty of people in the chat saying that you were impressively quick on solving some of these things.
I'm just so glad that it took more than 1 second for people to see words in the maze, because once you know that there are words there, it's all you can see.
Yeah, that's true. That was my favorite. Wow.
Just says here,
right. Wow. How did you design that? Did you do it in the thick cursive and then did the outline to it? That's impressive.
So I just used drawing program's layers function. So I just drew out the word and the arrow, and then I would erase things strategically and add all the other little bits in around it until it was ideally disguised enough.
And what was happening was in the bottom right corner of these clipboards? Was that covering something?
Oh, that bottom right corner? No, that was just her giving her commentary about her new beliefs about insects.
Nice.
Yeah.
Oh, I see. I'll just fly across was her just being nutty.
Mm. Yeah, something like, I have bug wings. Yeah. I'm glad I couldn't remember quite what she did at the end, so I'm glad I picked an appropriate voice for a strange bug woman.
You mean that was not rehearsed?
No, I just had a little script. It was all good. You all did really well. This room was originally a little bit easier. We made it. I play tested. We thought we can make it a bit harder.
That walkie-talkie puzzle was not originally in there, but you guys rocked it. I am so glad that it was there. It went exactly the way that I hoped.
And Emily Jillette.
The chat as well.
Yes,
with a little help from Tammy. Thank you, Tammy.
Yeah.
Yes, Tammy. All the hints in the chat, you were all very helpful. I hope you enjoyed the show. It was fun to do it as a live stream. It is a bit more pressure because I edit our show a lot, so everyone sounds incredibly smart and snappy and
beautiful. That's the future.
Thank you everybody for joining us as players. It was wonderful to have you. Thank you everybody in the Discord for following along. I hope you've all enjoyed your first day of Recon. I hope you all went to lots of fun talks and chatted. I was asleep for most of it because I'm in Australia.
We're going to have to catch up.
But that was wonderful. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, everyone at home. And I think that is probably the end of the stream.
High five, team.
Hi, everybody.
Thank you.
It was wonderful.
Good work, everybody.
Even until we're not live anymore. You've got to keep...